Although I feel a lot of BookTube talks mostly about modern fantasy, I think there's a place for some discussion about classic fantasy. Now, I will be having a discussion video defining what is classic fantasy, talking about all the stylistic differences between classic fantasy and what modern writers are doing. But today, I'm not going to talk about that. I'm just going to simply talk about 10 works of classic fantasy that I love. I've been reading fantasy since the 1980s. A lot of these works that I'm going to talk about today are works that I did read in the 1980s. Most of them I've revisited since then. And some of these works I've discovered recently. So for terms of this video, we're calling classic fantasy anything before about the turn of the century. We will define that term a little bit more concrete in that video. It's a discussion with three amazing people that I can't wait to talk about classic fantasy with. But for today, I'm going to give you 10 works of classic fantasy that I love. And then at the end, I'm going to give you 5 more that I still want to read because I'm not just a modern fantasy reader. I love classic fantasy as well. And if you clicked on this video, maybe you are too. So I would love to hear your favorites and some favorites that you look forward to reading. So without further ado, these are 10 works of classic fantasy that I love. Okay, first of all, this is not a top 10 list. These are not ranked. I have my 10, and I'm just going to lay them out basically in the order that they existed. Starting with something that is not technically fantasy because that term didn't exist yet. The term at the time was sword and sorcery, and I am talking about the works of Robert E. Howard, specifically the works with Conan the Cimmerian, Conan the Barbarian. I read all of these a little bit. I didn't read all of them in the 80s or 90s. I read some of them, some of the compilations of the paperbacks, but I read this entire Gallant's edition a couple years ago, and I just loved these tales. What I love most about these Conan stories is Howard's writing. It's kind of that early 20th century kind of prose that for some people it might be a little bit overly descriptive, maybe a little bit overly, I wouldn't even call it purple prose, but there's just immediacy to it that I enjoy. I love how in a lot of the action type sequences that you get in these Conan stories, that it just feels very visceral. I also love that the bulk of these are short stories. Nothing against epic fantasy, but it's sometimes nice to just digest small bits of fantasy. And all but one of the stories in this huge collection that I have of Conan the Barbarian are short stories. There's one novel that he wrote. Everything else is varying degrees of short stories. So I do love those. I think a lot of times modern readers dismiss Conan because of some aspects of the character itself. He is the typical Gary Stu. He is an infallible, overpowered protagonist, but I still love these stories. If you can overlook some of those kinds of things, you may love the Conan stories of Robert E. Howard like I do. So the Conan stories were in the 20s. We're moving to the 1950s and talking about the Chronicles of Narnia. I actually didn't know that these started before Tolkien, but the Chronicles of Narnia started in 1950, the 7-volume set. And I'll be honest, had I done this video 1 year ago, these would not have made my list. When I read these as a youth, 12-year-old Josh was just looking for something a little bit more adult, and these are kids' books. But adult Josh, reading these last year, I knew they were children's books. I knew that they were going to be whimsical. I knew that they were going to not be necessarily the most serious-minded type of fantasy, and I just embraced the youthfulness of it, the whimsical nature of these stories. I went in knowing that a lot of the allegory might be a little heavy-handed, or some of the themes might be heavy-handed because it was tailor-made for children. And what I found is I found that they were delightful. I didn't love all 7, but I loved enough of this series to put it on this list. And if you're wondering, a lot of people, there's a big debate about what the reading order should be, whether you should read publication order or you should read the in-world order. And there's even controversy among C.S. Lewis scholars. Well, I am firmly in the publication order realm with this. I think the best entry point to Narnia is through the wardrobe. All right, let's move next to 1954 and talk about The Lord of the Rings by J.R.R. Tolkien. I mean, what do I have to say? I have to say something because I'm going to shoot some B-roll and stick it in the video here. But Lord of the Rings is the work that basically kind of created the genre of fantasy, or at least codified it in publishers' eyes. But even more than that, I've read The Lord of the Rings 4 times in my lifetime, and each time I read it, I find something more to appreciate. In this last reread, what I appreciated the most was the world building. It just feels so real. It feels so lived in. It feels so detailed. And the reason why is Tolkien wrote volumes upon volumes upon volumes about Middle Earth just to tell us 2 stories, The Hobbit and The Lord of the Rings. And it shows. I still believe that Middle Earth and the world building of J.R.R. Tolkien has yet to be surpassed by any author. I've since put The Lord of the Rings 2 of my favorite book series ever, but in that regard, world building, I think Tolkien is still king. And if any of you say Tolkien is still king as far as the best fantasy series ever written, I will not argue with you. Lord of the Rings will always be on this list of 10 fantasy works that I love. Next up, let's talk about Elric of Melniboné, I hope I said that right, by Michael Moorcock. Now, Elric was born in 1961, and we've gotten Elric stories literally for the last 60 years. Moorcock did publish another book a couple years ago, and Elric is still just as great as ever. The Elric novels are very interesting in that a lot of them started as short stories. So a lot of them, he combined 2 or 3 short stories that were often linked by theme and kind of put them together. Sometimes they work great. Sometimes, honestly, I didn't feel they worked as well. But when they work as well, they are incredible. Now, this is a work of classic fantasy that feels very modern. Elric is not a stereotypical hero. You could say he's an anti-hero. And the world is not kind of sunshine and rainbows like a lot of works of classic fantasy. There's a lot of dark in these stories. The Elric novels I've read over the last couple years. So these are recent additions to this list for me. And I really enjoyed the trajectory of the series, especially culminating with Stormbringer. So unlike Narnia, Elric is not a series to be consumed in publication order. My recommendation for reading the Elric novels is to read the original 6-book box sets. It begins with Elric of Melniboné and ends with Stormbringer. Stormbringer is the best of them all, and it's the culmination of everything that in that box set builds up to it, even though Stormbringer as a novel was written before a lot of these other novels were put together. But the Elric stories feel very modern. They are shorts, which is another great aspect of a lot of the works of classic fantasy. You don't have to read 1,000 pages just to get through volume 1. The 6 books themselves are probably about 1,000 pages, but they're certainly worth your time. And I do love Michael Moorcock's Elric novels. Up next is the first fantasy series I ever read. It's the Chronicles of Prydain, or Prydain. I never know how to say it because I don't speak Welsh, but it's by Lloyd Alexander. And I will never forget, I've told this story on the channel before if you've heard it, my apologies, but 6th grade me walking into my middle school library for the first time, so excited to see what new books that my elementary school library didn't have. And I saw the cover of The Book of Three by Lloyd Alexander, and there was a figure on a horse with a skull with antlers, and my imagination just took off, and I picked that up immediately and checked it out and read the entire series very, very quickly. And I reread this 2 years ago. This is middle grade fare. I still enjoyed it as an adult. The 4th one, Taran, the main character in this series, goes through an existential crisis. That's really well done. It's a great fantasy series, and it would always be on this list for me as well, just because it was my introduction to the fantasy genre. So check out The Chronicles of Prydain, however you say it, by Lloyd Alexander. Up next is another far-spanning series, and that are the Earthsea books by Ursula K. Le Guin. The first one was published in 1968, the last one in 2001. I have the big omnibus edition that a lot of people enjoyed buying a few years ago. It's a great omnibus because it has, in addition to the 4 novels and the short stories, it has a few essays about Earthsea that I found quite enlightening. First thing I have to say about Earthsea is that I'm always surprised when people say that it's a work for children, because Le Guin's prose can be quite dense at times. I would never say it's unclear, but I would not say that it is kind of more simplistic like Lloyd Alexander's or C.S. Lewis's prose, when they were writing for a younger audience. So I'm always surprised when people consider The Wizard of Earthsea and the novels and short stories that followed it as children's works, because I thought it was perfectly suitable for an adult. What I like most about these is this is a very different kind of book series, that the stories don't necessarily connect in the manner of a traditional book series that kind of tells one story that culminates in a final book. These are different stories told in different places. And if you do read them separately of the Omnibus collection, do not skip the short stories. Read the short stories between the last two novels, because out of all of that, the short stories were actually my favorite. The amount of world building that Le Guin poured into those short stories was nothing short of remarkable, and in many ways informs the novels before it as well as the final novel. I really enjoyed Earthsea. It's a very unique reading experience, and one that I will definitely be rereading in the coming years. Up next, published in 1982, was The Belgariad by David Eddings. Now, this is a series that if you are a seasoned modern fantasy reader, I can say you can skip The Belgariad because you're probably not going to like it. But if you're new to the genre, you're not real well read in the genre, I always recommend The Belgariad as the starting point for reading fantasy. Why do I consider it the starting point? Because Eddings embraces all of the tropes and it works. And the reason it works is in The Belgariad, more so than his later works, he creates some really great characters here. And a lot of them are the fantasy archetypes that we know. We get the orphan farm boy chosen one trope. We get the old wise and wizard. We get the thief that more than meets the eye. We get the impetuous princess. We get the very regal knight. I mean, you get all of the tropes that you can imagine thrown all together. But in The Belgariad, I still enjoy it. Granted, a lot of it is nostalgia fueled, I will admit that, but if you're new to the fantasy genre or you have not read a lot of the fantasy genre, I wholeheartedly endorse The Belgariad by David Eddings. Check it out. So the next one on the list is something I discovered last year, and that was Legend by David Gemmell. Now, I will say that part of the enjoyment of the book can stem from knowing what was going on in Gemmell's life at the time. Gemmell was misdiagnosed as having a terminal illness. I don't know if it was cancer or what it was, but he thought he was dying. And this story is about an old man, a legend, who's coming back to help these people in a siege, and it's an unwinnable battle. But they're going to fight, and they're going to fight, and they're going to fight until they can't fight anymore. So knowing what was going on with Gemmell at the time, I think adds to kind of the allure of this book. But even more than that, the thing I always say about Legend is this is the work of heroic fantasy that I didn't realize that I needed in my life. I enjoyed this style of fantasy. I hadn't really read much of this vein, and this is great. Drus the Legend is just an incredible character, and he gives a lot of these kind of like pep you up type speeches that would be at home. Like I think of like Mel Gibson's speech in Braveheart or Bill Pullman's speech in Independence Day, these inspirational speeches. And there's a little bit of cheese factor, but I ate it up and I loved it. The writing is beyond solid. I mean, Gemmell is just a master craftsman. And this is a standalone. Now, it's part of the Draenei saga, which there are, I think, 9-ish books in that series, but they're very loosely connected. So you could read this as a standalone. And we know in the fantasy genre, there aren't as many standalones that are great. So Legend is definitely one to pick up if you want to check out some classic fantasy that's really about heroism. Up next is a work from 1986, and that is the Dragonlance Legends trilogy by Margaret Weis and Tracy Hickman. Now, back in the time, I did play Dungeons & Dragons, and these were based off of Dungeons & Dragons campaigns. And I think the publisher, I think TRS or TSR, one or the other, they produced these books that were Forgotten Realms, they produced Dragonlance, and they were both kind of role-playing games. The first series, the Dragonlance Chronicles, you kind of have to read first, unfortunately, and it reads like a D&D campaign. You get all of the characters that you would imagine. You can almost, like, read a character and say, oh, that character's lawful good, that character's chaotic neutral, whatever. But the second series, for me, is when you started to see that Weis and Hickman had some skill as a writing team. Not that The Chronicles is bad. I think I gave each book a 3 or 4 star rating. But the Legend series is a cut above. And my lighting just died. Hold on. And we're back. I don't remember where I was. I was talking about Dragonlance Legends. And this is where Weiss and Hickman, I think, showed their skill. The first series was pretty good. I gave it 3 to 4 stars per book. But Dragonlance Legends is where it gets really good for me. And this is the series that made me realize I want to follow these authors a little bit more. I don't know if I'll read more Dragonlance or read some of their other works. They have a 7-book series that begins with Dragonwing. I don't know the name of the series. I think that's the name of the book. But those two together are a very good author pairing. What I liked most about the Dragonlance Legends is it wasn't as formulaic as the Chronicles. Chronicles is very formulaic. You have all of the D&D characters. You have a typical fantasy story. Legends, the cast is pared down, and we have a more personal tale that revolves around the twins from the Chronicles, and all the books have twins in the title. There's time travel. There's a lot of kind of less orthodox storytelling from fantasy at this time. So I really enjoyed that series quite a bit. These are two series that I did reread, oh, I don't know, 3, 4, 5 years ago, something like that. And I will read more Weiss and Hickman, but Dragonlance Legends is a work of classic fantasy that I really do love. Last one on this list, I honestly feel has 1 foot in the classic realm and 1 foot in the modern fantasy realm. And that is the Empire Trilogy by Raymond E. Feist and Jannie Wirtz. And the reason I feel that it's kind of both of these things is there are a lot of very traditional fantasy storytelling elements, but there's so much novelty in there, such as there's no reliance on any of the tropes. And that's one of the things I think modern fantasy authors do very, very well is if they use the tropes, they usually subvert them. You don't really even see the tropes in this series. The other thing that I really like is this series really leans into political fantasy. And that wasn't quite the norm in the classic years as it is now, most popularized by George R.R. Martin and A Song of Ice and Fire. And I feel that this series probably compares right up with that one as far as political fantasy is concerned. But it also has some great characters. The main character, Mara, is one of my favorite fantasy characters, bar none. I think at the time that was probably somewhat unique, having a female protagonist for a trilogy. Additionally, I like the setting in this one. This was set in a world across the rift. It's set in Feist's Rift world, but it's across the rift in Kelawan, which is a world that is very Eastern inspired. And that's another thing that makes it feel a lot different, because so much of classic fantasy is kind of that European medieval model that Tolkien and others used so well. So this one feels a little bit different, but I wanted to talk about it because I read it last year. It was one of my favorite things that I read last year. And there's enough classic fantasy storytelling elements in there that I wanted to go ahead and put it on this list. All right, so those are 10 works that I love. Let's talk about 5 that I still want to read. Let's talk about one first that I did read in the late 80s, early 90s, but I don't remember a thing. And that are the Dragon Riders of Pern books by Anne McCaffrey. I've heard these also described as science fiction. I don't know how true that is or not, because there seems to be kind of a little argument when I see people talk about it. Some people say it's sci-fi, some people say it's fantasy, but they're dragons, so I'm going to call it fantasy. But I do want to revisit those. I remember enjoying those. I unfortunately donated my omnibus collections, which are unfortunately like major collector's items now, so I have to reacquire those books, but I do look forward to reading those at some point. Another series, I don't know if this is classic fantasy, I always thought it was, but I think it's more modern than I think, is Discworld. I've never read Discworld. I have 2 of their books right here. I have Small Gods and Guards Guards. These are 2 books that I were told were great entry points into Discworld, because there's a lot of different entry points and a lot of the books tie together, a lot of them don't. But I do want to read Terry Pratchett. When I did my last couple book series videos, my top 10 book series, when I did my fantasy tier ranking, and my light died again. This is killing me today. We are low budget today, let me tell you. But anyway, this is the series that people talked about the most, and it is one that I want to read. I'll be honest, I've read a little bit of Pratchett. I read Good Omens, didn't like it, We'll see if I like these books. Third on my list, I talked about Dragonlance. I do want to read some Forgotten Realms. I think I'll start with the Icewind Dale trilogy, which introduces the world to Drizzt, and then maybe read some Drizzt books, maybe read some others. I had a friend in high school that was reading Forgotten Realms. I was reading Dragonlance, and we would argue with each other about which one was better. And neither of us knew if the other was right because we weren't reading the other books. So maybe I'll read some Forgotten Realms and find out that he was right, or that I was. Who knows? The last two series that I really want to read that are classic fantasy are both Arthur retellings. And the first is a Mary Stuart Merlin Chronicles. And I have the first book here. I have The Crystal Cave. There are four or five books. I think it's four books in the Chronicles, and then the fifth book is kind of like an outlier or something like that. But I do want to read these. I love the Arthurian legend, and this is one I've heard that Mary Stuart's prose is amazing. So I do want to read these. And the other one is the Lioness trilogy by Jack Vance. That I've heard really, really good things about that author in particular, but also that series. So those are five that I hope to read and will read at some point. Well, I hope you enjoyed this video, despite the light dying twice and all of that. Anyway, I would love to hear any works that you love of classic fantasy. Put it in the description below. And then anything else that you're looking forward to reading, let me know in the comments section. I'd love to talk with you about those. Or if you just want to talk about the books that I talked about, I would love to hear your take on them as well. If you like this video, please like and subscribe. You can also find me on Twitter, Goodreads, and the Fireside Discord. Love to interact with you in all of those places. As always, thank you for watching. Until next time, goodbye.